A few years ago, I had this LED strip installed by an electrician in the kitchen. Works wonderfully, but now it doesn't work so wonderfully. What happens is you turn off the light, you go to turn it back on, and it doesn't turn on. And it'll be that way for a day or two, then all of a sudden, like today, it comes on. So I've been trying to diagnose the issue. I've tested the voltage here, which is DC, and I get a reading of 11.96. 12 is optimal. It's DC, as you can see here. So we know there's no issue with the transformer delivering the correct voltage to the unit. And yes, I said transformer, or also commonly known as the driver, which is this box here. We have 120 voltage coming in here. It gets processed and it comes out as 12 volts. So we do have 120 coming in. We have 12 volts coming out. It's just intermittent. So the issue's got to be with this box, that it's just starting to go on its way out. And yes, I've verified that the connections are good. I've opened up the box. There's nothing in there other than just the connection to the terminals inside the box. Everything else is just sealed off, so you really can't get to any of the electronics. So there are no switches or buttons to reset the unit. The way I troubleshoot this particular situation is I first verify that there is power going to the switch, which is the right-hand switch. So I have power going into that, going out. I verify that that power actually got down to this unit. And then I verify that there was output voltage leaving the unit, which is 12 volts. I verified that it went up to here. I looked for any breaks in the LED strip and satisfied that there are none, then the only logical conclusion is that this is the faulty unit that is causing the problem where it just won't come on until it decides it wants to come on. A replacement is over $100. I think it's closer to $200 for this box. Then I started looking around for something a little cheaper, because for the amount of money that I paid for this plus the installation, it should be lasting more than a few years. And I came up with the Armacost. It's a 60 watt standard LED power supply. It's a class 2. It has an input for 120 volts and it outputs 12 volts DC. These are the same specs as the more expensive unit, but at a much lower entry point. This was only about 30 bucks. It comes with a plug-in cord, or you can remove these terminals and you can direct wire into here and then come out direct wire to your LED. So since the wiring's already down there, I will lose this and just wire this unit in place. It has two places for mounting screws, lower right, upper left, or you can Velcro or double tape it into position. Now, unfortunately, my wife and I keep on thinking that, you know, once the lights come back on, that they're going to stay on, it's going to function as normal because it just healed itself. So here we go. We're going to turn off the switch and we're going to turn it back on, and no LEDs. And if we check voltage here, we get zero. So there's no power coming out of the unit, but there's still 120 volts going into the unit, and that's been already verified. And if you see, let's see, there's a little light there. So that lets you know that this switch is active. Otherwise, it wouldn't do that if there was no power coming into it. But again, we've verified that there's 120 volts going down to the transformer driver. So the first thing we need to do is disconnect power so that we're not dealing with live wires. And then we're going to disconnect the 120 line feeding the transformer driver, and we're going to disconnect the 12 volt line and noting where the polarity is, because if you mix polarity with the LED lights, then you'll either burn out the transformer or the lights. And of course, I'm going to use a non-contact probe to make sure this circuit is not active, that there's no power anywhere in here. And yes, I did verify this probe works by testing it on a circuit that was hot. In order to remove these cables, I'll need to remove the four screws to take this cover off so I can get access to where the connection is physically made. With the four screws removed, we take off the lid and we see there's another panel here. And like I said, underneath this panel, there's just no access to any of the electronics. But we can see that our wires have wire nuts on them, so that'll make it really easy to disconnect from there. And then I'll have to remove those two screws to get this to release the cable, and then wire nuts here, and again loosen those two screws here so that the cable comes out. In exposing all the wires, you notice that there's a neutral, the black, which is power, and then this particular unit has ground, which the new unit does not, but the new unit is actually double insulated on both sides, so there's no need for this to have a ground per the instructions. The difference between these two units is, one, just the sheer weight. This one's at least 3 to 4 times as heavy as this one. This is UL listed. This is ETL. This one's double insulated, so it doesn't need to be grounded, whereas the more expensive unit does require grounding. Now we proceed to the input side, and we remove the two Phillips fasteners, lift up the end cap, and there are two terminals. You'll need a small flat-bladed screwdriver to loosen them, and then you can remove the old power cord. Once removed, then we'll mount the unit and connect the power cable, making sure that we connect the load side, which is the black cable, to the L, and the neutral side, which is the white cable, to the N. It should look something like this. Then we proceed over to the 12-volt side, making sure that we match polarity, which is black is negative and positive is red. Of course, you can double check that by looking at the LED tape and making sure that's the way they did it. If not, make sure you match it. In the end, this is what the finished product looks like. You'll notice that the ground cable is not connected. It would probably be wise to put a wire nut on that. Now the moment of truth, we flip the power switch, and indeed the LED lights are working. Some of the tools that we used on this project were a work light, a screwdriver, you need a flathead and a Phillips. A non-contact voltage tester will come in handy, as may a wire cutter. And when testing for the proper voltage, it's good to have a multimeter. I'm using this Klein Tools digital multimeter. One of the nice things is that you can set it so that it records the max and the min, meaning the highest voltage and the lowest voltage, since when I was testing the voltage up here, I was paying attention to where I was putting my probes on the leads, and therefore I couldn't watch the display. So by locking in the two values, I could see that I had 0 volts when the probes were just sitting here, and once I made contact, I had the 11.96. If you found this video useful, give us a thumbs up, leave us a comment, join the subscription team, and as always, thank you ever so much for watching.